Thank you. The next item of business is a debate on motion number 607 in the name of Jamie Hepburn on gender in the workplace. Can I invite members who wish to speak in the debate to press their request to speak buttons now? I call on the Minister, Jamie Hepburn, to speak and move the motion. 14 minutes, Minister, or thereabouts.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I am very pleased to be able to open this afternoon's debate, the first occasion which I've opened a debate as Minister for Employability and Training on a subject as important as gender equality and the workplace. It is a subject which I think I'm right in saying that to a great extent unifies rather than divides our Scottish Parliament chamber, as it should, because whilst progress has been made and is continuing to be made, women in Scotland continue to face a multitude of barriers and inequalities in relation to the labour market. Challenging these inequalities will be a priority for the government going forward. Scotland's economy rests in the talents of our people. We, as an administration, and I'm sure collectively, as a parliament, would all agree that we can only really have a fully participative economy by harnessing our collective strengths, and by harnessing those collective strengths, we can be more productive, more innovative, and more successful. But to truly maximise our country's potential, Presiding Officer, we must break down the barriers that women experience in relation to work. Women in particular are the focus of this afternoon's debate, but this applies to other groups too, including people from ethnic minority communities, disabled people, and people who have experienced economic deprivation. Indeed, there will be many individuals, Presiding Officer, who fall into one or more of these groups, opening them to multiple barriers. On Monday, the Scottish Government published a research paper, New Perspectives on the Gender Pay Gap. One of the key findings of the research is that the pay gap differs greatly by age group and is a particular problem for older workers. The paper also reinforces much of what we know about the causes of the gender pay gap: occupational segregation, discrimination, and the inequality of unpaid care between men and women. And briefly?
I'll be brief. I'm pleased that you have mentioned, made a reference to older workers and older women workers in particular, but I think of all the briefings we've had, I think there's quite a big deficit in research on policy. I wonder if the Minister is going to address that in terms of the next of this Parliament.
Minister?
I will always be open-minded to, let me say, I think I know we've been meeting for a while now. This is my first opportunity to welcome Ms. McNeill back to Parliament. So let me do that if it doesn't feel somewhat late in the day in doing so. I will always be open-minded, Presiding Officer, to hearing suggestions as to where we could be doing additional work to look at any gaps in terms of data we collect. And let me reflect further on the point that has been made by Pauline McNeill, and I'll be very happy to look at that. And if she wants to contact me directly about it, I'd be happy to respond to her on that point as well. The paper also provides us with some reflections on the prevailing attitudes to the roles of men and women in relation to work and home. But the first thing, and something for us to welcome, is the substantial reduction in both the full-time and overall pay gaps in Scotland over the long term. The overall pay gap in Scotland, which reflects all workers, full and part-time, currently stands at 16.8%, still too high, but down from 26.6% in 1997. The full-time pay gap in 2015 was 7.3%, some 2.4 percentage points lower than the UK figure of the same year, and down significantly from 18.4% in 1997. So there has been considerable and positive progress. But if there is one word used to describe the gender pay gap, time and again, it is persistent. So whilst we welcome the progress, we are not complacent. We are clear that achieving gender equality in the workplace will require action on lots of different fronts. One such area we must focus on is that I mentioned a few moments ago, that of occupational segregation, the concentration of men in higher paying forms of employment and women in lower paying job sectors and industries, arguably one of the biggest drivers of the pay gap, which I think is reflected in the amendment in Mr. Rowley's name. And let me say at this early stage, Presiding Officer, we'll be very happy to support Mr. Rowley's amendment this evening, and I hope Parliament will join us in doing so. It is, of course, not an easy issue to address, the process whereby men and women are channeled into different jobs starts early, perhaps even from birth, when gender stereotypes start to be imbued, not maliciously, not nefariously, perhaps even unconsciously. So rooted are these traditional ideas about what is gender appropriate in our society. It's something probably all of us, if we are honest with ourselves, will be guilty of perpetuating in that unconscious manner I have referred to, even in small ways, from the language we deploy to the toys we buy for our children. So these gender constructs start very early, and they are easily carried into and through a child's education and into adulthood. That's why challenging the gender stereotypes that lead to girls and boys feeling that they can't study some subjects or do some forms of particular employment is vital. It's essential to challenge such stereotypes. And we are seeking to do this on a number of fronts and with the help of our partners. It is a top priority for the government's Developing the Young Workforce Programme, and we have set ambitious targets to increase the gender minority share in the most balanced college subject groups and modern apprentice frameworks by 2021. We are also investing £1.5 million over the next three academic years through the Scottish Funding Council in a programme of equality projects across Scottish colleges and universities, and we will continue to support third sector partners, including Equate Scotland, and Close the Gap to support the recruitment, retention and return of women in sectors where they are underrepresented, encourage workplace cultures and practices which support and sustain gender equality, and help young people to challenge gender stereotypes in subject choices and careers. We are also taking decisive action to combat pregnancy and maternity discrimination. This follows a report published by the Equality and Human Rights Commission last year, which revealed that one in nine new mothers are forced out of their jobs every year as a result of pregnancy and maternity discrimination. Presiding Officer, I think we would do well to reflect on the fact that not only is that totally and utterly unacceptable, but it is against the law. I am therefore happy to announce to Parliament that I will personally chair a working group to identify action to tackle this unacceptable discrimination, including by developing guidelines for employers to ensure that they meet their legal obligations. The group will also work with NHS Health Scotland to ensure that work environments are safe and healthy for pregnant women and new mothers, and to provide employment rights information for pregnant women at first contact. And I will be very happy to speak with any member of this Parliament who has a particular interest in the area if they want further details, and to keep Parliament informed of the work of that working group as it moves forward. Presiding Officer, the inequality of unpaid care between men and women is also a significant underlying driver of the pay gap. Women are more likely to work part-time in order to juggle caring responsibilities of children and grandchildren, but also of disabled or elderly family, friends or neighbours. The impact of women disproportionately shouldering these responsibilities is reinforced by a further piece of research published on Monday, investigation of pensioner employment, which looks at the experience of working pensioners. This research suggests that women or female pensioners tend to work in lower skilled jobs than their male counterparts, again, likely as a result of balancing work with caring commitments. This is not necessarily new, but what is interesting from the new perspectives in the gender pay gap was just how ingrained traditional attitudes about the roles of women and men are in society. According to social attitude surveys, there remains a persistent general view that women rather than men should make the compromises necessary to balance family and work, a view which is shared by both women and men. Of course.
Sandra.
I thank the Minister for taking intervention. Very interesting, the contribution about unpaid care. I just want to ask the Minister, and the legacy that obviously has been left from the previous Parliament and the new powers that's coming to this Parliament, will we be looking at the unpaid care aspect under any new DWP proposals coming forward to Social Security Committee, with actually looking at the fact that unpaid carers perhaps would be looked on more favourably in regards to sanctions if they're perhaps late for appointments or anything like that?
Minister?
Well, I think we'll need to remember that not all of this area will become the responsibility of the Scottish Parliament, so I wouldn't want to give unpaid carers out there the sense that we'll be able to do absolutely everything in that area. What I can say, though, and having been the Minister with responsibility for Scottish Government policy for carers, is that I think we do have a good track record of doing what we can to support such individuals. Of course, we, as a Parliament, just passed the Carers Act earlier this year, and it will now be for my colleague Aileen Campbell to implement that legislation. But I think that does indicate that where we have control of responsibility, we will do what we can to better support Scotland's unpaid carers. In terms of the point I was making about social attitudes, Presiding Officer, the prevailing view of both women and men that it should be women rather than men making the compromises necessary to balance family work, it does have interesting consequences for how improvements in family-friendly working policies and flexible working opportunities might impact on the pay gap. For example, if it is predominantly women who take advantage of these opportunities, then it's conceivable that the overall pay gap will widen rather than narrow. Now, that, of course, does not mean that we will stop promoting family-friendly working practices and flexible working opportunities. Far from it. That will continue to be a priority for us. It is incredibly important if we are to address the pay gap experienced by older female workers and female pensioners who wish to continue to work. But I do think we should support men to access those opportunities too, and to encourage employers to support women and men to return to work following a break, if that is their choice. And the Carers Act that I've just referred to should make a difference in that regard too. But also, we have announced that we will trial a new Women Returners project to help women back into work after a career break. This project aims to address this issue by working with employers to get the right processes and training in place to support women to transition back into the workplace if that is their choice. We are using the new powers transferred through the Scotland Act 2016, an area that was just raised by Ms. White, and this is an example of where we are using our new powers. So we're using the new powers transferred through the Scotland Act 2016 to remove the fees for employment tribunals, because a strong legal framework only protects women and indeed all workers if they can access justice. We'll continue to champion the living wage, which we know helps women who account for...
I think the member should be coming into his last minute. I know you've taken interventions, but if it's a brief one, I have no difficulty if the minister hasn't.
No, by all means.
I thank Mr. Jamie Kerr. Hepburn for his largesse. It's just on the tribunal fees point. Is the member aware that Unison has so far made two applications for judicial review of tribunal fees, both of which have been dismissed by the High Court, as there was insufficient evidence that the drop in claims since the introduction of fees was due to an inability to pay?
Minister.
Well, I'm sure the member thought that was a tremendously clever point, but what I can and know is the answer. I wasn't aware of that fact, but what I am aware of through my own work with the Cumbernauld and Kilsyth Employed Workers Centre, an important organisation based in my constituency, is the tremendously negative impact on low-paid workers that the introduction of these fees has had in terms of their ability to access justice, and we will stand by the move that we have taken going forward. As the point I was making, Presiding Officer, we will continue to champion the living wage, which we know helps women who account for 65% of employees earning less than the living wage. Right now, working with the Poverty Alliance, we have over 550 accredited living wage employers in Scotland. We aim to reach 1,000 such accredited employers by autumn of 2017. We, of course, pay the living wage to all those covered by our own pay policy, and it is probably an appropriate juncture then to set out that that's the reason we will not be supporting the amendment in the name of Ms. Wells, because she, of course, refers to us should be welcoming the UK government's introduction of the national living wage. We know that that is anything but, that is a con trick. It isn't the living wage. It's not the living wage that's set out by the Living Wage Foundation. That's the living wage we will stand by. That's the one we will continue to pay, so that low-paid workers, especially low-paid women, can benefit by it. And we will continue to do all we can to ensure that we take every effort and stride to reduce the gender pay gap and ensure that women have the same opportunities as men in the Scottish workplace. I move the motion in my name.
Thank you, and I give the Minister some extra time for taking interventions. I now call Annie Wells to speak to and move Amendment 607.1. Ms. Wells, please.
Thank you.
Nine minutes or thereabouts.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I welcome, as I'm sure many do, Scottish politics' strong engagement with issues of gender equality. Scotland's largest three parties are now led by women, Ruth Davidson, Nicola Sturgeon, Kezia Dugdale. And as Ruth showed last week in the televised debate, women can be as formidable as any man. I am not, however, naive in thinking that everything is hunky-dory. There is much more to be done to promote gender equality in public life. Although female employment figures in Scotland are at a record high of 71%, only second to Sweden, I want to look at more complex forms of inequality in the workplace. To address this, we need to look at the lack of women in STEM subjects, the gender pay gap, and issues surrounding inflexible and unaffordable childcare. As it stands, women are still underrepresented in a variety of spheres. While female employment recently hit record highs in Scotland, women make up only 36% of public boards, less than 35% of MSPs, and 24% of councillors. As Equate Scotland does much to publicise and address, women continue to be underrepresented in science, technology, engineering, and maths. For example, in 2014, we saw that only 3% of engineering modern apprentices were female. And in a recent Education Scotland report, it was found that girls only represented a mere 20% of higher computing. This is why I'm pleased to see that the Scottish Conservatives support for the Royal Society of Chemistry
in an endeavour to get STEM specialists into primary schools. With regards pay, there is still a sizeable pay gap between men and women. Women managers earn on average 22% less than their male equivalents across the UK, and a woman earns on average 80 pence for every pound earned by a man. This is why I welcome the UK government's proposal to push business employing more than 250 employees to publish the difference between average male and female employees. We are lucky as MSPs to work in an environment where pay is transparent and fair. Unfortunately, this does not apply everywhere. The likes of Norway, Belgium, Iceland, Italy, the Netherlands and Spain have all introduced mandatory gender quotas, with supporting claims that they can speed up women's representation where it is developing too slowly, and that provide a positive counterbalance to existing discrimination. So what's not to like? Well, I believe that gender quotas are not the best tool to achieve equality and diversity for a number of reasons. Firstly, positive discrimination of this sort runs the risk of alienating women who have achieved their position on merit. Quotas could foster attitudes that women have been successful only because of this, rather than being recognised for their achievements. Quotas tend to drive their own behaviour, fulfilling the targets but masking and ignoring underlying problems with organisational attitudes and infrastructure. Gender quotas can have an unintentionally negative effects, continuing to entrench gender inequality. This is most clearly seen in Norway, where a small number of women sit on multiple public boards in order to fulfil the gender quota commitment of 40%. This has led to a small group being nicknamed Golden Skirts. A recent study found that over a period of 4 years, 8 women had more than 16 directorship appointments compared to only 2 men. This only aids to serve a very narrow group of women, rather than securing wider benefits. It has also been shown that stock prices and asset values dropped following the introduction of quotas in Norway, and it led to younger, less experienced and less capable boards. Nor are gender quotas fully supported by British business. A recent study by the Chartered Institute of Personnel and Development found that 60% thought that mandatory quotas should not be introduced. Several respondents felt that mandatory quotas could result in a numbers game rather than addressing the real issues concerning female progression to senior roles. I share this view that quotas lead to the glossing over of structural problems once the box has been ticked and targets have been met. The factor I find most convincing against quotas is that they undermine women's confidence in their own abilities, as colleagues presume they have reached their position only because of their gender rather than merit. Studies by the psychologist Hillman between the mid-80s and mid-2000s found that women hired and explicitly identified as being hired under quotas were generally seen to be less competent and deserving of their positions. This applied even where it could be demonstrated that they were as competent and as qualified as their male colleagues. The work of the UK's Davies Commission has shown that a voluntary business-led approach can be successful instead of using mandatory quotas. There are now no all-male boards in the FTSE 100, and there has been no shortage of experienced, capable women to fill these seats. Women on Boards UK now count nearly 10,000 aspiring women in their network, and executive search companies have also adopted a second voluntary code to promote transparent and fair recruitment practices. All of this has been achieved without the need to rely on mandatory quotas. There are clear alternatives to mandatory quotas in order to boost female representation. Promoting good work-life balance is crucial to ensuring both women and men can thrive in organisations. Accessible and affordable childcare arrangements are a critical part of this, and I have referenced in my amendment. The Scottish Government plans to double childcare for 3- and 4-year-olds. Whilst 30 hours a week is again in theory fantastic, hours are split into blocks of 3 hours and 10 minutes. For the majority living hectic lives and for anyone working 9 to 5 or shift type patterns like I did in retail, the numbers, although high, are unworkable. Glasgow-based campaign group Fair Funding for Our Kids has worked tirelessly to highlight this issue. Beginning their focus in the city, they now champion reform countrywide, arguing that families are not able to make the most of their entitlements because of the unsuitable hours offered by most council nurseries. We need innovation, like we see in Sweden with the use of a child credit or voucher system. Parents should be able to use their hours how they wish, using a mixture of private, local authority and partnership care. This is the only way we will be able to accommodate any increase. As it stands under the Scottish Government's proposals, doubling childcare eradicates the one-day models made up of one morning and one afternoon sessions. A new 9-to-3 model will require huge investment in childcare, something not accounted for by the Scottish Government. We estimate 650 new nurseries will need to be built and 3,250 new nursery staff trained. The move to 30 hours a week will result in a 40% reduction in available council places, with 72,000 places needing to be found. I'm actually in my last minute, sorry. In Glasgow alone, it is estimated that there will be a shortfall of nearly 3,500 nursery places for children aged between 2 and 5, and this is echoed elsewhere in the country. What the Scottish Conservatives champion is establishing unbiased HR policies that are regularly monitored and reviewed. It's also a step in the right direction. This includes establishing a transparent recruitment process, free of bias. Organisations must also do all they can to retain talented women. And this can be achieved through dynamic career planning, so employees have a clear sense of direction, solid promotional opportunities for women, and high levels of support, training, coaching, and mentoring for all staff, regardless of gender. Closing the gender pay gap between men and women would also make for a fairer system, and providing positive female role models within an organisation sends out the message that women can get on. What all of this boils down to is they need to have an open and supportive culture in an organisation, one which values merit and one which allows women to rise through the ranks. To conclude, rather than rigid quotas, I would like to see women's progression supported by open and supportive working cultures, transparent and unbiased recruitment processes, clear career paths, and good work-life balance achieved through flexible working and appropriate childcare provision. Thank you.
Just ask you to move the amendment, please.
I move the amendment in my name.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Call Alec Rowley, please, to speak to move amendment 607.2. Mr Rowley, 7 minutes or thereabouts.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I welcome this debate? I think the level of interest that has been created in this debate and the number of briefs that we have seen coming in from many different organisations shows how important this issue is viewed across Scotland. What it also shows is that there's a lot of expertise out there and a lot of organisations that want to see Scotland making really good progress. And in the discussions that we've had so far in terms of the community's brief, we have said that to be able to create a joined up strategy across Scotland and an inclusive strategy is the only way that we will actually make real progress on so many of the issues that sit across this brief. Added to that, of course, is that we need joined up government. And as we will see, and as you can see from the briefings that have come forward, the many issues, if they are to be tackled, as the Minister said, there are many actions on many different fronts. If we have to actually achieve those actions on many fronts, then we need joined up government here, working with joined up local government, working with the dynamic third sector that we have in Scotland. And that's got to be our aim if we're going to move these issues beyond simply having debates in this chamber to actually making really good progress. And I accept, and why I would be supportive for the motion, is that progress has been made, but we need to make a lot more progress. I'm also pleased that the Minister has said that he would accept the amendment that has come in from Labour. Could I just very quickly say, in terms of the Conservative Party amendment, we need to stop confusing the increase that George Osborne brought about in the minimum wage with a real living wage. It creates confusion, and the two are not the same thing. I mentioned the briefs, and many of the briefs that came in. One that came in from Close the Gap, they talk about education and skills pipeline. And I quote, they say, gender segregation is evident along the skills pipeline, with assumptions made about the capabilities and interests of girls and boys from preschool onwards. From a very early age, fixed ideas based on gender norms and stereotyping influence the decisions that children and young people make around subjects and career choices. And I think that's absolutely correct. I was thinking this morning about the time that I visited the aircraft carrier project in Rosyth, and went on the new aircraft carrier and came off and was in the meeting. And somebody said to me, did you notice very many young women, girls out there as apprentices or as engineers on the ship? And I said, no. And they said that if I had gone to any other major engineering project across Europe, then I would not have found that same situation. So there seems to be a British or a Scottish thing going on here, and we can maybe learn some of the lessons from the rest of Europe in terms of encouraging people for a young age. Indeed, most of those engineers that were on that carrier project would have been earning fantastic salaries and a real bright future in front of them. But yet in Scotland, we don't seem that to be the case. And I also reflected when thinking about that, my visit just a couple of weeks ago, 2 weeks ago, to the Celtic Community Centre. One of the head teachers had asked me to come along for the STEM family morning. And it was a catchment of the Beath catchment area, primary schools, and it was children and their parents and their guardians, their grandparents in some cases, all carrying out different exercises around STEM. And one of the points that was made to me by those teachers there that day is you actually have to also involve families and encourage families to encourage children to get involved in the different subjects that were there. It would be right, of course, for me to also flag up to the former Education Secretary that in terms of the STEM subjects, local authorities have a difficulty in many areas in actually recruiting the specialist teachers. So there are issues there. Already, I think that demonstrates the need for joined up thinking, and at a local level, as was evidenced to me in Kelty that day, you need local strategies that are also put in place to match a national strategy. So really, I mean, I can never stop saying enough about the need to ensure that we do have a joined up strategy. The briefing from Engender, I thought, said to me, it really described exactly where we were when it said the gender pay gap persists at 14.8%, with women who work part-time earning 33.5% less than men working full-time. Women are 75% of the part-time workforce. Women have less access to occupational pensions than men. Women are 66% of the paid workforce living in poverty in Scotland. On average, women earn £175.30 less per week than men. 64% of these workers paid below the living wage are women. 40% of low-paid workers are women working part-time. 55% of workers on zero-hour contracts are women. I just thought that these statistics were quite stunning and should galvanise us all in this chamber to say that actually, yes, we should debate this, but we should start to look at what action we're actually going to take as we move forward. It was mentioned earlier when the Minister spoke about Social Security and the powers that are coming to this Parliament in terms of Social Security. But again, Engender point out in terms of Social Security, they say that the Scottish Government has the opportunity to design replacement programmes with gender equality as a central aim. New powers over employment support offer the potential to design programmes that take account of particular barriers faced by women in the labour market. Failure to do so will ensure that women are further entrenched into low-pay, low-valued and often less secure work. So there is something specific moving forward using the new powers, social security powers that are coming to this Parliament that we would be able to do if we so wish. I was just struck by another point that was made by Engender, and that was in terms of workers' rights. They say that legislation introduced by the previous UK government and plans by the current government have severely restricted and will serve to further restrict trade union activity in the UK. Again, there is a lot of detail there, but there is work going on between the Scottish Government, the Scottish Trades Union Congress and trade unions, and we should ensure that and looking at that work, that we address these issues. The STUC, in a recent report, Women and Work partnership project highlight a lack of accessible, flexible and affordable childcare emerge as one of the main barriers for women fully participating in the labour market. I certainly know as a granddad how difficult it has been when my granddaughter was younger for my daughter to be able to find the childcare and indeed afford the childcare. And some of the statistics that we've been given in here in terms of the cost of childcare. And if I could just one very brief, because it was the
Mr.
poverty...
Mr. Rowley, I hate doing this too, as I've done it before.
I know, the Poverty Alliance...
This has been really ultra brief.
The Poverty Alliance really highlights some of the key areas in childcare that we should tackle. I would finish by saying, let's bring all these different people together. Let's not just have a debate in here. Let's look at what the strategy is to tackle these issues.
Thank you very much. We now move to the open debate. Speeches of 6 minutes or thereabouts, please. Claire Adamson to be followed by Rachel Hamilton.
Thank you,
Ms.
Presiding
Adamson.
Officer. I was very pleased that the Minister had concentrated on the pay gap in his speech this afternoon, and it's an area I want to cover this afternoon as well. And I also absolutely agree with Mr. Rowley in his assessment of the confusion that has been caused by the term living wage coined by George Osborne, which is not our understanding in Scotland of what the living wage is. It does occur to me, and I wonder if the Minister might respond to this or have a think about this, is just as we have living wage accreditation in Scotland, that we might consider equal pay accreditation with the same benefits of living wage accreditation in terms of government contracts and how we do business in this country. In my office, I have the Close the Gap poster of a smiling young boy and a very frowny young girl. And the slogan on it is, prepare your daughter for working life, pay her less pocket money than your son. And I'm always amazed at the controversy this caused when there are young school children of whatever age in my office, because they often say, do you really believe that? So the irony is lost on them at that stage. And the males and female young people alike say, that's just so unfair. And it amazes me that what is unfair to our very young people quickly becomes normalised, institutionalised and condoned in our working environments. The Equal Pay Act came into being in 1970, and yet we still have such limited progress in this area. In a Guardian article in 2014 called Mind the Gap, When Will Women Finally Be Able to Celebrate Equal Pay, it highlights the work that has to be done, that we still have a 20% pay gap in the UK. And I want to commend Jo Swinson MP on the work that she did in this area, in the areas of mandatory publication of gender pay differences and league tables. But the big question for all of us is why is this taking so long to tackle, and why are we revisiting this time and time again in this chamber? In September of last year, The Guardian had an article on the accountancy firm Grant Thompson's report, Women in Business, The Value of Diversity. And it states quite clearly that women who companies that have at least one female executive on the board perform better, and that's a study across UK, US and India. Publicly traded companies with male-only executive directors missed out on £430 billion of investment returns last year, and the accountancy firm found in its report that the value of women and diversity in the workplace is damaging the economy in this country. So what do we have to do? Just appoint a woman to a board, and then performance will increase and everything is solved and there's no other problems going forward. But life, as we know, is not that simple. What is probably much more likely is that the companies who value diversity at all levels within their workplace, as evidenced by a woman achieving board status, perform better because diversity really matters in decision-making, in innovation, in all areas of business. I'd like to return to my previous employment in the IT industry, and in a blog piece in 2014, Fiona Woods, who was the head of human resources in Cognizant, did a blog piece about the difference between decision-making, the left and right brain, difference between women. And she said that what it means for the IT business is that gender differences encourage various perspectives and ideas from individuals that foster innovation. Different voices and views lead to new ideas and the creation of new services and provide valued insight to customers. What's interesting is in 2014, the British Computer Society were recommending that this be done through diversity training and embedding it into our HR departments. Only in April 2016, the BCS also decided that it would recommend a fresh look at quotas. And it has done some research, and it shows all the things that have already been mentioned today by many speakers in the Parliament about role models being so important, about the issue of the pay gap having to be tackled, part-time working, childcare, recruitment processes. But they've moved away from the diversity training because what they're saying is that the three perceived barriers preventing women achieving senior executive positions are senior male executives recruiting in their own image, the unconscious bias issues, and returning to work after a career break. And it's this unconscious bias that we all suffer from. Marketers will tell us, advertisers will tell us about it, but we seem to miss out on it in the business context because you cannot feel belonging to an organisation if you cannot see yourselves in the people round about working with you. I'd like to thank Sandra Pickering of Open2 for a blog piece where she says, the psychology of non-conscious influence tells us that how the most powerful people look becomes desirable and normal. Until diversity is clearly the responsibility of the CEO and the board itself reflects that diversity, then this will not change. I think this is one of the most important areas that we have to tackle if we are to achieve gender equality in all aspects of what we do. I think that the work that's been done by Agenda is very important in this area, and Equate Scotland do much in the STEM subjects, but we have a lot to think about how we tackle this in the future.
Thank you very much. Rachel Hamilton, followed by Gillian Martin. Ms. Hamilton.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. It's great to observe today that female members outweigh male members by 16 to 12, but this is not normally the case. Today, the motion recognises our cross-party determination to bring about gender parity. The Scottish Conservatives understand it is vital that we tackle the root causes to help close the gender gap in the workplace. We've proposed common sense policies relating to childcare, apprenticeships, and the participation of female pupils in STEM subjects to help redress this balance. Looking at the motion reminded me of a number of points in my own life. Firstly, my education at school, where competition was fierce but good-natured, didn't necessarily prepare me for the wider world. Observing the outcomes of my two eldest daughters, one at university and one in sixth form, made me think about what the Scottish Government has done to support women from school and into the workplace, and indeed if we have made any progress at all. Today, although 60% of new university graduates are female, women are outnumbered by men in leadership positions in the corporate sector in the UK. Perhaps this reflects on the current failings in the curriculum for excellence to promote STEM subjects to females, or indeed a much needed collaboration between the business sector and schools to create an understanding of what qualifications and skills are really needed. Research by the Scottish Conservatives has highlighted that the Scottish Government is failing to increase the number of female pupils studying subjects in science, technology, engineering, and maths. In 2015, just 47% of maths exams were sat by girls, compared to 49% 8 years ago. Over the same period, the numbers studying computing fell from 24% to just 17%. Physics and technology numbers remain much the same, with only 28% sitting a higher physics exam in 2015. Sectors which depend on STEM graduates have long complained about a shortage in applicants from Scotland's schools and colleges, particularly females. Recent figures have shown the number of teachers in STEM cells has dropped. For example, we have 300 less maths teachers. The 152,000 college places lost under this government does not help, as it is shown to particularly affect women. And let us not forget the single mother, the woman returning to work or caring for her family deserve opportunities too, and benefit greatly from vocational learning opportunities. The Scottish Conservatives want to expand prospects for women, have consistently made the case for more vocational and educational skills training to be aligned with business demand. Per head of population, Scotland has only half the number of apprenticeships as England, and we believe this must change. We want to see an additional 10,000 apprenticeship starts every year by the end of Parliament. We recognise that many women count themselves out before they ever even get to a selection or recruitment process, and my experience mirrors that. Collectively, the Scottish Government need to address why that is and what obstacles we must overcome. Like many women, my career path was peppered with difficulties, not created by a dearth of ambition or lackluster attitude, but by a recruitment process dominated by men in suits. In 1992, girls had to be as tough as ever. I remember manning up and shifting my acquiescent manner to an attitude that allowed me to be treated as an equal or one of the boys, as they say. My own experiences have shown me the need to challenge pregnancy and maternity discrimination. Understandably, my natural instinct was to be with my firstborn daughter. Many of you may remember Nicola Horlick juggling a multi-million pound fund manager's job and five children, setting an almost unachievable target for many women. After getting to grips with looking after a very new baby and guided by maternity laws at that time, I headed back to work just after 12 weeks, grappling with a full-time job ill-suited for motherhood. A request to my boss for flexible or part-time hours was greeted with the answer that if he allowed me to have special working hours, all the men in the organisation would have to be treated the same too. My options were to shut up or get out. The underrepresentation of women in the workplace has been a persistent issue in both public and private sectors, particularly in senior positions. However, it's worth pointing out that the latest ONS labour market figures show that UK-wide employment rate for women is at 69.2% and is the highest since comparable records of 1971. It's clear that when we get gender balance right, corporate success improves dramatically. The benefits of women in boardrooms brings a new way of thinking, plus other elements that men are not predisposed to. In Scotland, we're fortunate to have a number of noteworthy women working in our significant public sector roles. Auditor General Caroline Gardner, Alison Dorolo, recently appointed Solicitor General for Scotland, Dr. Catherine Calderwood, Chief Medical Officer, and Elaine Lorimer, Chief Executive for Revenue Scotland, are all key role models. There's much more work to be done, particularly in relation to the retention of women in the workplace and their progression up the career ladder. But these women set an example, proving that senior board level positions are achievable. They have earned their place through merit, just like their male colleagues. I would argue that the recruitment and selection process plays a more significant part in achieving board and senior level representation, and it's an area that we should be tackling. It's true that promotion comes at just time when women start to have families, with expensive childcare and few meaningful family workplaces. I seem to have come to an end, so I'm going to close there by just saying, to close, Presiding Officer, it's disappointing that we've lost college places and created more barriers and not extended more provision to childcare. And I'm sure that through the Parliament, we can work together to overcome these challenges.
Thank you very much. Gillian Martin, to be followed by Monica Lennon. Ms. Martin.
Well, I hope one day that we'll not have to have this debate, as gender in the workplace will be irrelevant. But for me, it wasn't until I worked in the private sector that my gender became something which I felt was an issue. I was brought up in a household where I was never made to feel that I couldn't achieve anything because I was female. And then went on to university where, as you know, you exist in a forward-thinking, liberal, egalitarian bubble. So it came as a bit of a shock to me when I encountered discrimination in the workplace. Not really just because of my gender, per se, but because I did what, thankfully, a lot of women do. I decided to have a baby. I'd recently been in charge of some major projects after only being with the company for a couple of years, and there were talks of management training programmes coming my way. So when I asked for a meeting with the managing director to let him know my baby news, I got the first indication that all would not be well. "I thought you were interested in your career," he said. I took only 3.5 months off from maternity leave, because maternity leave and pay wasn't as good then as it is now. And when I came back, there was no further talk of management training. My maternity cover replacement was kept on, and large projects seemed to go to them instead of me, and I dared never to ask for any flexibility to any working day for fear of further discrimination or disadvantage, much like Rachel Hamilton has just said. I lasted 2 more years in this environment until I went into teaching, into the public sector, when in having my second baby 5 years later, I found out that attitudes to returning mothers were completely different, supportive, flexible, and non-discriminatory. And as a consequence of that, and so many other things, I stayed in that job for 15 years. Now, which organisation got the best bang for their buck out of me as a worker? The flexible, supportive one, or the one who couldn't go over the few months of maternity cover that had cost them? Still, I'm 18 years on from that negative experience I had, and the government motion cites a great range of drivers towards helping women make a substantial contribution to Scotland's economy, and I welcome every single one of them. And if there's a theme to my contribution to this debate, it's this, that those drivers do not cost companies money. They make companies money. They are an investment. Recruiting and keeping good quality workers is key to a company's success and profitability. And Annie Wells is not here just now, but she talks of the cost of childcare. Well, I'm just going to talk about the cost benefit of childcare, although I'm not really going to talk about childcare. These measures aren't just there to help parents, and largely women, access the world of work. They are measures that will grow our economy. And I want to stress that these drivers help fathers play an equal part in their children's care as well. I remember reading a study from the Institute of Public Policy Research a couple of years ago, which concluded that one of the main provisions which contributed to an increased female work rate was being given more control over their working schedule. If work was flexible, women tended to be able to work more hours and stay longer with an organisation. Allowing flexible working unlocks employee potential, improves productivity, and as we've seen in a lot of cases, in the Nordic countries lead the way on this, particularly Sweden. And of course, when we talk of flexible working, there's a tendency to assume that this means part-time work, and that is largely the case at the moment. The difficulty we face is the nature of most part-time work in Scotland's private sector. Part-time work opportunities are disproportionately allocated to more elementary occupations, relative to and at the expense of professional occupations. And those professional institutions are missing a trick. That's not to say that they're not part-time workers in the professions, but the IPPR same study found that most were as a result of negotiation once a full-time worker was in post. For women re-entering the workforce from a period of no employment, this is a real problem, in that the availability of part-time flexible work at the recruitment stage is so skewed towards low-skilled, low-pay work. And that means that professions are missing these skilled women looking for work within their skill set, but wanting flexibility to fit in with their family commitments. By not advertising that part-time and flexible work is available, companies are limiting their pool of talent on which to draw. For every woman re-entering the workforce after their break to care for her children that has to take a lower paid job underneath her skill set, just because it's more flexible and fits in better with our family life, it's not just the woman who loses out, it's also our economy. It is a missed opportunity for our business to recruit and retain talent. It's less tax being paid. Yes?
Alec Rowley.
Gillian Martin for giving way, and I agree with everything that she's saying, but does she accept that in Norway and Sweden and these countries that their childcare is far superior, but they also raise taxes to be able to ensure that happens.
Yeah. Well, one other thing I would also say is they also are in control of their entire fiscal area. So the taxes coming back, I actually made a comment on that in another debate I was making about how the Norwegian Prime Minister cites women working and paying tax as being the number one source of the wealth of Norway. So if we had that fiscal arrangement where we're able to look after all our money, I'm sure that we would actually be in a situation where we're able to generate a lot more money as well. It's less tax being paid, its skills been underused, it's a sheer and utter waste of education and expertise, and it's a major contributor to the gender pay gap. And I heartily welcome Claire Adamson's suggestion on this pay equality accreditation. You nearly got a standing ovation from me. Professional women driven into work below their skill set due to lack of flexibility costs Scotland money. And flexible working for dads too might mean that we have a future where debates of this nature are not needed.
Thank you. Call Monica Lennon to be followed by Christina McKelvey. Ms. Lennon.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Today, children and young people have unprecedented access to technology, but having an iPad at your fingertips isn't necessarily going to lead to a young girl aspiring towards a career producing software or designing apps. And if she does, like we've heard today, already she knows it's very likely she'll achieve more but earn less because of her gender. On the day of the Scottish Parliament elections last month, I was standing outside Whitehill Neighbourhood Centre, which, as well as acting as a polling station, was also serving as its usual community hub. Two girls from Primary 7 at nearby Beckford Primary School struck up a conversation with me. They began by giving me some political advice that parties should work together more, they said, and politicians in general should stop shouting at each other. And with current events in mind, I'm wondering if they're available over the school holidays to offer further counsel. But what struck me most about the conversation was that they were very excited about coding. They were learning how to code in class. And they were also very aware that if they went on to work in the technology industry, they would be paid less than their male counterparts and be less likely to reach senior positions. That was their expectation. At the age of 11 in Scotland in 2016, here were two young girls standing outside their youth club telling me they expect to earn less than boys and not have the same opportunities, even though they might have the same or higher qualifications and abilities. They understand the gender pay gap. Both of the girls were articulate, confident, funny, and very, very smart. Instinctively, I could tell they have so much to offer our community, our economy, and our wider society. Dozens of times since our conversation, I thought of them, and I feel guilty that we're letting them down. Today, we've talked a lot about the leaky pipeline in STEM subjects that sees girls either choose not to pursue science and technical subjects through school and university, or if they do, not continue on to STEM careers or reach senior levels such as their male counterparts. We've heard a lot of the statistics, and I won't repeat them, but the evidence is stark. 73% of women who graduate in STEM subjects don't stay in the sector, which is an enormous waste of potential. Last week, I saw that the Herald covered National Women in Engineering Day, which had been launched by the Institute of Civil Engineers Scotland. The article highlighted Scotland needs an extra 440 new civil engineers this year to meet its needs. Yet further education engineering students are down by a third since 2010, and 7 out of 8 ICE members are men. I welcome the Scottish Government report to address underrepresentation of women in STEM and recognise that this will be done in partnership with the Scottish Funding Council, our colleges and universities, and I welcome the additional £1.5 million investment in equality projects. But more must be done, Deputy Presiding Officer, and Scotland has to catch up. Sarah Tyham, Director of ICC Scotland, points out that Scotland does lag behind much of Europe in terms of gender-balanced workforce, and she warns employers who ignore the benefits of attracting more women into the profession risk becoming increasingly marginalised. And further, Belinda Oldfield, a Scottish Water executive, says, it's quite shocking that less than 7% of parents with girls would recommend engineering as a good career route for their children. As Jamie Hepburn alluded to, old-fashioned attitudes do persist and do so in our homes, in our schools and our workplaces. But today we should recognise some of the good practice that's out there. And Close the Gap have already been mentioned. The Be What You Want work across schools is enabling young people to make informed subject and career choices, encouraging them to take or to pursue non-traditional jobs. This initiative also provides resources, importantly for teachers and career advisers, on occupational segregation and gender stereotyping. Also, the Institute of Physics has produced a study which finds that career materials are not gender neutral. So there's a huge amount of work to be done to make sure that this good practice can be rolled out further, because we know that if children are conditioned at a young age to conform to gender roles, then barriers will reinforce the structural inequalities in our labour market. I've been sitting here again thinking about my own daughter, who has come home from school and activities on numerous occasions to complain that the teacher or the coach isn't a feminist mum, because they've asked strong boys to volunteer to lift some chairs or have assumed that girls don't want to play football. I'm heartened that many young women are growing increasingly impatient, and I reflect the comments that Claire Adamson made, and are not willing to put up these attitudes that are holding them back. Much of what I was going to say has been said, but I want to pick up on the issue around gender quotas, because quite simply, there's a lot of rubbish being said about that today. We know in this chamber that equality doesn't just trickle down. It's not enough to have a few women in positions of political leadership. That simply, it doesn't do. And I note that Annie Wales is speaking tonight at the Parliament event tonight to try and encourage more women to stand. And I hope we'll have a genuine conversation at that event. There's some excellent speakers on the programme, least of all Nan Sloan, who has done terrific work across this field. But we have to challenge these misconceptions out there that gender quotas somehow produce women who don't have the same merit as men. And we haven't seen progress sustained in this chamber. And, you know, I think it's a fact that it's simply as a result of the success that the Tories have had at the polls, they didn't have enough women candidates, and that's why we've seen this Parliament stagnate in terms of women's representation. So,
The member's just concluding, and I hope shortly.
I'm being told to sit down, but I hope you're coming to the event tonight, because I think we have to continue this conversation. Thank you.
I think I was so rude as to say sit down. Can I move on? It's Christina McKelvey to be followed by Alison Harris. Ms. McKelvey.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. It is with the same pride and the exact same passion that I continue to address the societal and structural imbalance that affect women, with this imbalance being particularly relevant to women within the workplace. So for all of my life, Presiding Officer, whether it be as an MSP, a trade union official or an activist, I've also always championed the fight for women's equality. And I will continue to do so, because it just seems to be in my DNA. It's with great privilege that I support this motion, and I welcome the release of the report from the Scottish Government, which ultimately shows where this government's priorities lie in reducing the mass discrimination felt by women in work, thus giving those women the rare privilege often solely enjoyed by men. Opportunity. The opportunity to carve out a successful and thriving career, not based on anything other than their talent and their fortitude. The opportunity to break out of the cycle of poverty, unleashing a woman's full potential to the world of work. The report shows that the pay gap in Scotland has reduced substantially from 18.4% in 1997 to 7.3% in 2005. We still have a way to go. This means that for a whole generation of girls and young women taking their first tentative steps into the workplace, they can do so without having the same fear and gender restrictions that once controlled them, or their mothers, or their grandmothers. For this, the government should be congratulated, but we will not rest on our laurels, as I've already said, there's still a way to go. We will not be confined to the small-time kitchen mentality that once defined a generation of our women. It's through specific policies of this government that we have sought to address the societal imbalance I talk about. This can range from the transformative funding for quality, affordable childcare, which we have implemented and continue to do so, to the initiatives we have taken to tackle maternity and pregnancy discrimination within the workplace. I'm sure a topic we will take up in the Equality and Human Rights Committee at some point. And if you will forgive me, Presiding Officer, it is of the latter point that I wish to return to what has already been well-worn debate over the past week, the European Union. The European Union provided extra safeguards. against maternity and pregnancy discrimination. The EU Pregnant Workers Directive, for example, which guaranteed the right to paid time off to attend antenatal appointments, benefiting over 430,000 women workers per year. This now faces an uncertain future, but I suspect from this place it won't. These are the rights that now come under severe threat, a threat brought on by the pure complacency of a Westminster Conservative government that was too preoccupied with appeasing its right-wing factions that it forgot what it left behind. And what did it leave behind? It left behind the hard-fought-for workplace rights that of society progressives throughout Europe. Undoubtedly, this uncertainty will impact greater on the precarious women worker than it will with any other cohort. It is this theme of precarious work and of gender-specific work that this government seeks to address in the future, and indeed, the published report calls for more to be done to tackle the occupational segregation that still exists between genders. And I'll just highlight that South Lanarkshire Council has still to sort out its gender pay gap after all of these years. And why should women conform to the atypical maternal career role that society often expects of them? What can't women seize the reins of prosperity and occupy that which the report deems to be the highest earning occupations, the managers, the directors, the senior officials, the doctors, the consultants, the lawyers? It is on this point that this government moving forward will really make its voice heard. And I suspect many across this chamber will raise that voice too. The ambition to have diversity in the boardroom, to have 50-50 by 2020, is an ambition that is challenging, but certainly worthwhile. And things that are worthwhile are usually never easy. And presiding officer, I may say to you, well-behaved women seldom make history after all. It is my determination that when the next generation of women...
Why do you take that personally, Ms McKelvey?
I think many of us can, presiding officer, many of us can, and I absolutely welcome the fact that we do. It is my determination that when the next generation of women reach the world of work, that there will be no glass ceiling or sticky floor to their ambition. There will be no restriction on their ability to dream. What will matter will be their talent, their skill, their hard work, and rather than sex or gender of the individual, that's what we will focus on. For the plurality of modern apprenticeships available to the living wage, and I mean the real living wage, for social care workers, to the Family Friending Work in Scotland partnership, this government has set out bold and transformative policies that can accelerate this decline of disparity and help transform women's lives within the workplace. I think, along with many of my colleagues across this chamber, women and men, I'm sure we're all committed to ensuring that we create the best environment for our women and our girls to work and grow in. And if we do that, we make the world a better place for our men and boys too.
Thank you very much. Alison Harris, we're followed by Ruth McGuire. Ms. Harris, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'm delighted to have the chance to take part in today's debate, as it is a vitally important subject. It is important for a variety of reasons, but above all, it is crucial that we ensure women face no extra barriers because of their gender in their chosen careers. It goes without saying that women contribute a huge amount to our businesses and public services, and it is essential that they continue to do so and that they have the opportunity to do so. A quick glance at the latest labour market figures from the ONS show that across the UK, the employment rate for men was 79.3% between January and April this year, compared to 62% for women. I understand that the latter figure is the highest since comparable records began in 1971. In Scotland, the Scottish Government's annual population survey reports that the employment rate for women between April 2015 and March 2016 increased over the course of the year by 0.2 percentage points, from 69.5% to 69.7%. This compares to an increase of 1.1 percentage points for the rest of the UK, from 67.5% to 68.6% over the same period. Clearly, progress has been made both nationally and in Scotland, but there is still a great deal that needs to be done to achieve greater parity in this regard. Deputy Presiding Officer, I want to turn briefly to occupational segregation, one of the barriers which prevents women from fulfilling their potential in the labour market. Fundamentally, women should have the opportunity to work in traditionally male-dominated industries, in science, research, engineering and technology occupations. The breakdown between men and women is 78% and 22%. In skilled metal, electric and electronic trade, only 2% of the workplace is represented by women. Now, if women don't want to work in these sectors and occupations, well, that's fine. But what happens if they do want to work there? We need to overcome the stereotypes that often underpin occupational segregation, and we need to give women the opportunity to enter traditionally male-dominated sectors. To this end, we need to look at skills training and apprenticeships, and we need to encourage more women and girls into studying STEM subjects, an area where the SNP's record is woefully poor. Regarding apprenticeships, in Scotland, there is a huge gender imbalance. Skills Development Scotland figures for 2014-15 show that whilst broadly equal at modern apprenticeship level 2, by level 3, around 2 times as many men start, and at level 5, 10 times as many men start. This is clearly disappointing, and the reasons for this need to be understood and addressed. Equally, there have been some disappointing figures relating to the number of females studying STEM subjects. Skills Development Scotland emphasises that these subjects are dominated by men. And, extremely worrying, 73% of STEM graduates are lost from STEM occupations, compared to 48% of males. Furthermore, while some STEM subjects have seen improvements, there are still some worrying signs. In 2007, the statistics show that of students who took higher computing, as we've already alluded to today, 20% were female, whereas in 2015, we can see that only 17% of those studying higher computing are female. These figures highlight that the trend is going in the wrong direction. It is abundantly clear to me that only by giving women the opportunity to learn skills and undertake training in these sectors can we hope to make any meaningful progress in addressing the gender imbalance. This has to be kept in mind through all stages of life and education. Girls must be encouraged, starting from home, through primary, secondary schools, to apprenticeships and on to universities. Whilst I believe that opportunities and encouragement must be given to females to study these subjects and enter male-dominated workplaces, I must state that it is not my belief that we should impose gender targets across the workplace. I believe that women deserve to be chosen on their own merits. They should be chosen for their talents and because they are the best person to do the job, not because they happen to be female. Across the political landscape, private industry and our public services, women have reached the top, not because of a quota imposed by the powers that be, but because of what they have to offer. Artificial quotas aren't the answer. The solution lies in education and in providing sensible policies that knock down existing barriers. Thank you.
Ruth Maguire, to be followed by Andy Whiteman.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Like colleagues across the Chamber, I strongly welcome the recent publication of new perspectives on the gender pay gap. In particular, its conclusions that the gender pay gap, both full-time and overall, continue to reduce, and that it's lower in Scotland than in the UK. Of course, we still have a long way to go, and I equally welcome the report's highlighting of where this work is most needed, as well as our government's clear commitment to working with partners to continue to tackle the gender pay gap and other gender-related inequalities in the workplace to ensure that nobody in Scotland faces barriers to subject or career choice due to their gender. As we've heard today, many of these gender-based inequalities disadvantage exclusively or predominantly women. The gender pay gap is a clear example, as well as issues of pregnancy and maternity discrimination and affordable childcare. Occupational segregation, however, is a workplace inequality of detriment to both men and women, as well as to the overall social and economic well-being of Scottish society. Whilst women are disproportionately affected by occupational segregation in financial terms, clustered in undervalued, low-paid and unpaid work, a situation unfortunately familiar in other industries too, in terms of fulfilment of individual potential, both men and women lose out. And if we look at the impact on wider society, we all lose. As much as we need more female scientists, we also need more male nursery teachers and male social care workers. I'm sure some colleagues will share my concern that a series of recent reports have shown that despite higher numbers of women studying STEM subjects than ever before, successfully building a career in science remains difficult for women. Firstly, there remains strong, unconscious and subtle bias against women in the publications and research grant applications process. It's been shown that both men and women rate identical scientific papers more highly when they're submitted under a male name, that female-authored submissions are reviewed more harshly, and that men have higher success rates than women when applying for research grants. A recent study by the British Medical Journal has also shown that the number of women listed as lead author in high-impact journals has plateaued or declined since 2009, at a level below women's representation in the medical community. This is all crucial because securing academic funding and getting published are central to pursuing a career in science. In addition to women's voices not being taken as seriously, a recent House of Commons Science and Technology report highlighted how women also have to compete against structural bias, with initial scientific careers dominated by short-term contracts and poor job security, often exactly when women who wish to are looking to start a family. This can leave women faced with a choice of career or family. Not only does the glass ceiling in science stop women from fulfilling their individual potential, in economic terms, the late Professor Ailsa Mackay estimated that the lack of women in science and engineering occupations represents a loss of £170 million a year to the Scottish economy. And in policy terms, we lack female voices. That's the input of more than 50% of the population when it comes to research and provision of evidence that will drive future healthcare policies and standards of care. As such, it gives me great pleasure to note the Scottish Government's recent announcement of £79,000 of funding to continue the CareerWise programme set up in 2013 to offer female undergraduates paid employment with STEM employers. I also welcome the continued government funding of the partnership project Close the Gap, dedicated to addressing women's inequality at work, as well as the establishment of an advisory council on women and girls to advise on tackling workplace and occupational segregation. Whilst women often have the required scientific qualifications but face difficulties in pursuing a scientific career, in terms of men entering into traditionally female domains such as childcare, we've yet to overcome the first hurdle of encouraging men to study the relevant subjects in the first place, with college courses focused on care strongly dominated by women. Not only does this gender bias hinder individual men from fulfilling their potential, it also can limit the experience and development of our young children. It's crucial for them to have positive male and female role models from an early age, to experience different perspectives, interaction and play in their nursery setting. And of course, crucially, to see that caring, nurturing and empathy are healthy and positive for men and women. I've mentioned them before, but I'm going to take the opportunity again to commend the work being done in my constituency by Ayrshire College for their ongoing efforts to challenge gender stereotypes and promote the role of men in care work and inspire more men into the profession. They recently held a successful recruitment event to encourage men into programmes such as their HNC in social care and their early education and childcare courses, which featured the testimony of men working in care. And was advertised by what I thought was a very evocative and powerful hashtag of This Man Cares. Tackling occupational segregation and indeed addressing all matters of inequality is not just about fairness. It's about Scotland's overall economic and social well-being. I look forward to supporting the Scottish Government and working with others in the Chamber and partners locally and nationally to make sure that skills available to employers are not limited by gender stereotypes and that men and women have equal opportunity to fulfil their potential.
Andy Whiteman to be followed by Fulton MacGregor.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. On behalf of the Scottish Green Party, I very much welcome the Scottish Government's report.
new perspectives on the gender pay gap, and the news that the pay gap in Scotland is in long-term decline. The report makes clear, as others have pointed out, however, that the pay gap is a complex phenomenon, and so that whilst the overall trend is encouraging, progress has been less impressive in sectors such as older workers and in those in senior positions. Of the many factors at work in producing the gender pay gap, as we've heard, horizontal occupational segregation is a significant one. And having raised this issue during the Holyrood elections this year, we're particularly grateful that the report, or we particularly welcome the fact that the report focuses on the severe underrepresentation of women in particular sectors of our economy and overrepresentations in others. For example, women are more likely to find themselves in work such as retail that's insecure, undervalued and poorly paid. And whilst we continue to argue for a real living wage and better working conditions for everyone regardless of their gender or employment, it's clear that this alone will not be enough to eliminate the gender pay gap. As we've heard, underemployment of women in science, technology, engineering and maths is particularly acute. According to Labour Force survey figures, women represented only 13% of the UK STEM workforce in 2014. Segregation within education and training is a serious and ongoing problem. For example, between 2010 and 2015, there was only a 1.5% increase in the proportion of female modern apprentices in engineering and a dramatic fall of around 35% in information technology. The apprenticeships in which women dominate, such as early years care and education and hairdressing, are shorter in duration, less generously funded, have lower rates of pay, higher dropout rates, and poorer labour market outcomes. This is all the more of a pressing problem given the major skills in STEM sectors of our economy. Scottish Power, for example, has warned of a major skills shortage in the energy sector, with 80% of their engineers due to retire within the next 20 years, and at present only 16% of the energy workforce being female. The Scottish Green Party manifesto called for an occupational segregation commission, and so we welcome the government's very similar plans to establish an advisory council on women and girls to advise on action to tackle workplace and occupational segregation. Whilst there's been laudable ministerial focus on occupational segregation for some years, not enough progress has been made to open up sectors of the economy closed to women, and I hope the advisory council will help ministers to redouble their efforts. I want to move on briefly now to the role of employability support in helping to address pay gaps. As Alex Rowley observed earlier, a recent report by Engender argues that current employability programmes, particularly those delivered by the UK government, do not sufficiently consider the employment challenges facing women. An individual's readiness to work is influenced by their education and skills, by their caring responsibilities, by their safety at home and in the workplace, and by the types of work they're able to access. Women have different experiences than men in all of these areas. Employability programmes need to, but do not currently take account of these differences. And indeed, with the closure of the Edinburgh employment charity Women Into Work last year, there are currently no employment programmes specifically targeted at female job seekers. As gender and labour market experts close the gap note, the generic skills support offered by current employment programmes, especially by the UK government, is likely to replicate gendered patterns of skills acquisition and employment, and this is likely to entrench further occupational segregation and widen the gender pay gap. So as we prepare for the devolution of the UK employment programmes next year, I'd urge Scottish ministers to consider how the Scottish replacements for the work programme and work choice schemes can be made gender sensitive. The promotion of women's economic equality should be a cross-cutting theme of employability programmes, being included as part of funding and evaluation criteria. I would also commend Claire Adamson's proposal for equal pay accreditation, and I would suggest the government explore all possible options for encouraging businesses and employers to step up to the mark on equal pay, including options around, for example, how we deliver things like the non-domestic rating regime to businesses. I'd also like to mention very briefly the UK government's scrapping of employment tribunal fees. or rather their introduction of them. Official statistics show an 81% drop in claims lodged between April and June 2014 compared to the same time in 2013, with sex discrimination cases reducing by 91%. This is why we called in the election campaign for an end to tribunal fees, and we welcome the Scottish Government's pledge to do this when the power is devolved, because clearly people who feel that they're being discriminated against must have access to justice. To conclude, the new perspectives on the gender pay gap report was very clear that inflexible working practices are a major barrier to women's access to employment and a cause of the gender pay gap. There's a wealth of evidence, both in that report and many others, to suggest that women bear the brunt of employers' unwillingness or inability to offer flexible working. We require very great cultural and attitudinal changes by employers, and the support, the Scottish Greens offer all support to the government in achieving a reduction in the gender pay gap. This accords very much with our fundamental principles of equality, peace, environmental sustainability and radical democracy, and we look forward to working with the Scottish Government to further these aims.
Fulton MacGregor, followed by Mark Griffin.
Presiding Officer, and let me just start by saying that I am very pleased to be given the opportunity to speak in this important debate. I welcome the substantial difference that the Scottish Government has made in relation to the gender pay gap, and the advances in recent years are incredibly encouraging. And I believe this improvement is in no small part due to this government's progressive policies in areas such as the living wage and childcare policies that have already been mentioned by other members. The plans to increase free childcare further to 30 hours per week will bring more benefit for families and particularly mothers across our country. In this day and age, it's disgraceful that some women are unfavourably treated just because they are pregnant or because they are a mother. This results in many feeling they have no alternative but to leave their employment, and it can, of course, continue to impact on them in the future. Increasing childcare will help to counter this, but I feel that there needs to be a more understanding, compassionate and inclusive approach across all sectors in supporting parents and, as I said, particularly mothers. Female employment, as we have heard, is on the rise and the pay gap continues to decrease, but there is more we can do, and I welcome the plans set out by the Minister earlier today. So while there have been great steps taken in relation to the gender pay gap, all of us here recognise that there is still some way to go. And we must continue to put pressure on organisations throughout the country to put an end to gender pay inequality as quickly as possible. On that note then, I intend to use the remainder of my time to highlight the problems facing many employees, both serving and retired, of North Lanarkshire Council surrounding equal pay claims that have been going on now for many years. And I would point out to members at this stage, to declare an interest, sorry, that I was a councillor at North Lanarkshire Council until just earlier today. And that's unrelated to this debate. While this issue of equal pay has affected male employees, the overwhelming majority of those affected are female. What worries me is the way in which North Lanarkshire Council, although not alone, have fought the equal pay claims by their workers for more than a decade. Some members may know that there have been two claims. I'm sure Claire Adamson will agree with me here. First wave claims relate to the period prior to the introduction of the new job evaluation based pay arrangements in 2007, and the second wave claims relate to the period after the introduction of these arrangements. I'm also deeply concerned at reports that some employees have been told that they must sign confidentiality agreements, and some have had the offer of compensation withdrawn in cases where they have discussed a settlement with peers or published it online. There have been concerns and dispute over whether these claims are pensionable. North Lanarkshire Council still hasn't ruled out a legal challenge to the Scottish Public Pensions Agency, which ruled that arrears of pay should be pensionable. This relates only to the second wave claims that I mentioned, as the Council has already accepted that first wave claims should be pensionable. However, on that point, Mark Irvine from Action for Equality Scotland told me just yesterday that, and I quote, the first wave claims have been adjudicated by a formal decision of the Glasgow Employment Tribunal in May 2015. North Lanarkshire Council accepts that these claims can and should be made pensionable if the claimants wish so, but over a year after the decision, the Council has still not actioned people's requests. This is absolutely unacceptable. North Lanarkshire Labour must recognise that the money that has been awarded is not compensation or some sort of bonus. It's back pay of wages previously short paid. The sad fact here is that people are dying, in some cases, without seeing their claims completed. The workers of North Lanarkshire shouldn't have to keep fighting for what is rightfully theirs. It's time for the Council to own up, step up and make these payments. The Labour Party in North Lanarkshire regularly highlight the financial position of the authority, and I think we all accept that all levels of government in Scotland face budget constraints caused by continued unnecessary Tory austerity from the UK government. I would suggest that North Lanarkshire's problems are largely down to its over-reliance on PPI projects, some of which have left the people of North Lanarkshire with crippling repayments. In addition, it seems to me that if the Council had settled these equal pay claims earlier and sorted out the issue at the first opportunity, they wouldn't find themselves feeling that they must now fight this claim from staff, which is a legitimate claim. There is now a new leader in place at North Lanarkshire Council, and I welcome that he has said he is keen to resolve this matter. I do hope that he does now deliver for these workers who have waited for so long. Needless to say, however, should the SNP take control of North Lanarkshire in May, there will be changes around how the council conducts itself in matters like this. And I also feel that I can assure people involved in equal pay claims that should the SNP emerge as a majority party next year, there would be an aim to have the claims settled at the earliest opportunity. Equality in the workplace isn't something we should have to engage lawyers to achieve. It's something that we should be provided in all walks of life without any question. Next.
Mark Griffin, to be followed by Ben McPherson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I welcome the opportunity to speak in this important debate today about gender and the workplace. We should challenge discrimination and loss of opportunity wherever we see it, and there is no bigger impact than that of gender discrimination. 50% of the population affected by the issues raised by Engender in their briefing for this debate. I thank them and the many others who've contacted MSPs with briefings, I think, showing how important this issue is taken inside and outside the chamber. What they said was that occupational segregation, ungendered employability programmes, unpaid caring roles, violence against women, and different forms of discrimination all contribute to the gender pay gap, which is a key indicator of women's inequality in the workplace. Now, I have a 7-month-old daughter, Eva, and my wife and I will do the best that we can to give her the confidence and the skills that she needs to succeed. And I can already see how bright she is, and I've got visions of her growing up into a successful engineer or scientist. Certainly no danger of gender segregation in the Griffin household, Minister. But the point here is that she shouldn't have to work harder or need the extra encouragement to pursue a career in science or technology than our neighbour's baby boy who was born just a few weeks later. Now, in our approach to the debate today, we've suggested an amendment which highlights that the employment and industrial barriers faced by women have a negative impact on Scotland's economy, with the Royal Society of Edinburgh explaining in their recent report that the lack of women in science, technology and engineering and mathematics jobs is a loss of a potential £170 million a year to the Scottish economy, a point made by Ruth Maguire in the debate today. And I appreciate the government support for our amendment this afternoon. I've said before in this chamber and still believe that the Scottish Government must prioritise supporting women into STEM industries where they're currently grossly underrepresented. And I think we need to take a look at the jobs and industries that will give people the best opportunities to succeed. Those will be the high-skilled, high-paid jobs in science, engineering and technology. There just isn't a future for Scotland as a low-skill, low-wage economy. There isn't a future competing with developing countries for those jobs, and how we give all of our young people, or people who want to retrain, the chance to get a job in a high-tech industry will play a massive part on how we take our country forward. And to do that, we need to break down
the barriers faced by women. And there's a massive prize to aim for there. According to research, over 7 million jobs in the UK will depend on science skills by 2030. Those STEM jobs are exactly the kind of jobs that we need. High quality, high skilled, highly paid jobs, which other emerging economies just can't compete with us for. And I studied mechanical engineering at university. A key source of skills and graduates for that sector, a course which provided fantastic opportunities for high skill, high paid work. There were 120 students on my course. Four of them, just four from 120, were women. How this government opens up careers in science and technology to half our population will determine how they will determine how successful they are at tackling issues of gender in the workplace. And it's clear from the in gender briefing that curriculum segregation is still evident at school and college, and even before we get to universities. In colleges, women are clustered in art and design, 72%, care, 73%, hairdressing and beauty, 97%, and languages, 64%. Men are more likely to be found studying construction, 92%, engineering, 87%, nautical studies, 93%, and land-based industries, 68%. That's a figure that you see repeated again and again and again. In universities, more women studying subjects than men related to medicine, social studies, and languages, while men dominate in mathematical and computing science, engineering technology, and architecture. And as far back as the high school classroom, subjects are being gender divided. Young men studying technological studies at 93%, graphic communication at 71%, physics at 72%. More young women studying home economics at 92%, administration 77%, biology 64%, and art and design at 82%. The figures in that in gender briefing make stark reading, and I think it will probably just confirm what most of us will already know. But as I said before, there is a big prize to aim for. Those 7 million jobs in the UK that are going to depend on science skills by 2030, the jobs for the future that we need. And we have a challenge in giving people the skills and training that they need to apply and succeed in this area. But if we simply accept the barriers to half the population advancing in this key area, then we've already lost out. Presiding Officer, for Eva and for the other women who are battling to succeed, we all have to do more. Thank you.
Ben McPherson, to be followed by Sandra White.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I also welcome the publication of the Scottish Government's report, New Perspectives on the Gender Pay Gap, illustrating that the gender pay gap is lower in Scotland than in the UK and has reduced substantially over the long term. I also welcome the Minister's opening remarks and the content of the motion. The title of today's debate, Presiding Officer, is Gender and the Workplace. However, as has been evidenced, the overarching issue for discussion is, of course, the wider matter of gender inequality and its importance to us all. Let's be clear, as detailed in the Labour amendment and passionately articulated by Gillian Martin, gender inequality not only undermines the integrity of our society, but it also significantly undermines our productivity, our competitiveness, and the fulfilment of our economic potential. Therefore, I very much welcome the wide range of Scottish Government policies designed to help close the gender pay gap and the progress made by the Scottish Government, from encouraging payment of the living wage to increasing free childcare, from challenging pregnancy and maternity discrimination to addressing occupational segregation, towards working towards gender balance on boards to promoting family-friendly and flexible working. These policies are and will make a difference, and we should support them. Presiding Officer, I would also like to congratulate employers in my constituency and across Scotland who are paying the living wage at the moment, and also the local and national initiatives who are promoting payment of the real living wage. This is an extremely important matter for creating equality and also enhancing demand and productivity in our economy. Furthermore, Presiding Officer, I would like to congratulate proactive national organisations, for example, Family Friendly Working Scotland, who are working directly in the area of gender in the workplace specifically. And I look forward to meeting with them in the coming weeks to learn more about the progress Scotland is making, as well as the challenges we still face. Presiding Officer, as well as highlighting the progress made, the report also recognises that a significant gender pay gap persists for some age groups, sectors and occupations, and explores key drivers such as traditional, social, employment or attitudes and culture. And in light of this, I would like to comment on the corporate private sector of our economy, and particularly the corporate legal sector. Prior to being elected, I worked as a commercial lawyer with one of Scotland's many outstanding firms. With a female chairperson, a high proportion of female partners, and increasing opportunities for flexible working, the business I worked for was impressively sensitive and aware of gender equality matters and had a forward-looking human resources strategy. However, the legal sector as a whole is an interesting industry to examine when it comes to issues surrounding gender in the workplace. As reported in December 2015, Scotland now has more female than male solicitors for the first time, after a sharp increase in the number of women qualifying as lawyers. Figures from the Law Society of Scotland reveal that 51% of Scottish solicitors are now women. This figure rises to two-thirds for solicitors under 40 and 64% for those admitted in 2015. However, women are still underrepresented when it comes to senior roles with private firms, as well as at the bar and in the judiciary. And more strikingly and unjustly, according to data from July last year, the gender pay gap for solicitors in Scotland is currently a staggering 42%. That is totally unacceptable. I highlight this not only to raise awareness of this deep inequity, but also to emphasise the wider point that significant gender pay gaps persist for some sectors and occupations, and that this, again to reiterate, is because of traditional social or employment attitudes and culture. In the corporate world, for example, the normality and expectation of long working hours and often unnecessary presenteeism is prohibitive to those with young families or ambitions for a reasonable work-life balance. And while shifts in social attitudes are occurring, and while our Scottish Government is taking action to encourage this where it can, as outlined by the Minister earlier, for clarity, I think it is important to acknowledge that much of the policy agenda relating to gender equality in the workplace and many of the potential solutions orientate around employment law and company law, neither of which this Parliament has power over. And Presiding Officer, in these times, and to echo what Christina McKelvey said, I think it's important to acknowledge the valuable contribution that European law and European Union membership has made towards strengthening employment rights, including in areas directly related to gender equality in the workplace. Therefore, Presiding Officer, as well as endorsing the resolution before us and the Scottish Government proposals within it, let us also bear in mind that securing Scotland's continued membership of the European Union matters, and it matters when it comes to building more equal workplaces in our country for our fellow citizens and for generations to come. Thank you.
We now move to the last of the open speeches. Sandra White, please.
Very much, Presiding Officer. And if I could just turn to Christine McKelvey, mentioned about cheeky women. I wouldn't call myself cheeky, but I'd just like to say the reason and one of the ways I was involved in politics was that when my kids were young, there was absolutely no playgroups, no nurseries, anything at all. And I took on board that, and I started up these summer play schemes. And through that, I became elected as a councillor. It was the only way I could continue with that. Now, I didn't see myself as being cheeky. I just saw that as being an injustice. And obviously, it was the women and their children who were actually being hard done by. But I know that other people within the council saw it as being cheeky. simply because I was a woman. So I thought I'd throw that in and let you know that being a cheeky woman or whatever, or injustice, certainly set me on the road to politics. Presiding Officer, can I welcome the contribution that the Minister has made today and others as well. I think it's been a very, very good debate, but in particular the Minister's contribution, which recognises the inequality of unpaid carers, which, as many members have also highlighted, affects more women than men. Indeed, women provide around 70% of unpaid care and twice as likely to give up paid work, which is a very, very hard choice in order to care for someone, which means that 74%, huge amount, 74% of claimants for carers' allowance are indeed women as well. And I take on board what the Minister has said in regards to the welfare powers being devolved, and I do welcome the Scottish Government's commitment to equalise carers' allowance with job seekers' allowance once carers' benefits have been devolved. I think that will make a big improvement, and I thank him for that explanation also. Now, Alex Rowley also raised an issue which I wanted to raise as well in regarding other programmes, you know, coming forward from the DWP to the Scottish Parliament, the employability programme, the works programme, and choice are being devolved under the Scotland Act 2016, which was already mentioned by the Minister. And I believe that gives this Parliament and the Scottish Government the opportunity to look at programmes with gender equality basically as a central aim of these work programmes. And I do look forward to having meetings and through our committee also, but also exploring the concept along with the new powers of employment of support, which takes into account barriers faced by women who are in work and actually are returning back to work. Because that's a huge barrier when you're on even some form of carers' allowance, where you can only get a certain amount of money. Indeed, I'm sure all of us here have had constituents who have only been allowed to work a couple of hours a week, simply because if they earn just above that, then they completely lose all of their caring allowance, even if it's for, you know, a disabled child or whatever. That's no way to encourage people into work. And as women make up the largest amount of carers, I think it's discriminatory against women. So I do look forward to looking at that part, you know, of the Social Security Committee. Now, one of the areas that was raised, and Claire Adamson raised it at the very beginning of her speech or later on, was the unconscious bias. And I think we're all very, very aware of the unconscious bias which exists. Monica Lennon raised it even further with the fact that when she was speaking to a couple of girls at the polling station, they were, you know, unfamiliar with the fact, or familiar with the fact, but didn't seem to mind, if you excuse me for saying that, that even though they were going to get a job exactly the same as men, they were expecting to get less monies. And that's really quite shocking, and it's quite worrying that young girls in this day and age expect that. And that is an unconscious bias, not just from their point of view, but from the point of view of, you know, what's been put out there. And I'm going to come to that particular part. I want to come to the media with my last couple of minutes. And we really need to tackle this particular issue of unconscious bias. We'll have to look at the situation where, and Mark Griffin picked up on this as well in regarding careers. I mean, the huge discrepancy in careers. Now, we have to support people in their homes and schools. We have to look at career advice as well. We need to look at what's happening perhaps in schools and why young girls are being put down that road. Maybe not being put down that road, but not being encouraged to take up other forms of employment. And certainly we looked at that in the Equal Opportunities Committee, the previous committee that I was on. We certainly looked at that, and certainly there was some evidence there that perhaps they were not getting the best career advice. But if I can just return to the media. I think it's something that we all pay attention to, but they're never called to account for the way they portray females, young and old, in the media. You just need to look at anything at all in the newspapers, in the TV, whatever it may be. The way they portray women, I'm not even talking about the page three or whatever it may be. Certainly, I don't think they'd like me on page three, but never mind. I'm not even talking about that. I'm just talking about the fact that they see very, very flippant, you know, about women and girls and careers. And young girls are very susceptible to peer pressure. I mean, they see that forthcoming through newspapers, you see it on the trains, buses, whatever it may be, every other day, that women are not given the proper place in this society. And that filters through to jobs and the level of jobs that they can receive and also the perception that men have of them. And I think that's something we really, really need to tackle. I know I've only got 2 seconds left, Presiding Officer, so I'll finish just now. But I think a very, very good debate, looking at all various aspects of it. But we really need to look at the media in this. And if they can put forward positive images of young girls, women, females, then maybe we'll be a wee bit long on the line of looking at this unconscious bias. Thank you very much.
Now move to closing speeches, and I call Pauline McNeill for 6 minutes, please, Ms McNeill.
Presiding Officer, I most sincerely welcome the Scottish Government report, New Perspectives on the Gender Pay Gap, New Solutions, perhaps, and listening to the debate this afternoon, perhaps perspectives haven't changed as much as we would have liked. Inequalities remain deep. And as the wonderful briefings we've had from organisations like Engender, who say that the grotesque disproportionate impact on women still exists. As members talked about this afternoon, occupational segregation is a real challenge. And I wholeheartedly welcome that Jamie Hepburn is going to be chairing the Advisory Council for Women and Girls. And I think that it has the possibilities of making a generational difference. But we know that women have always had to fight for their rights in society. The bias that Ruth Maguire talks about in an excellent speech, cheeky or otherwise, as said by Sandra White. But I hope that the next generation of women who will continue to fight for these rights will recognise that we have made progress, but they will know that we still have to travel far. Women are the frontline victims of austerity. Women have fewer assets. They are less likely to be part of an occupational pension scheme. Staggeringly, they are 92% of lone parents and 75% of part-time workers. Globally, according to Oxfam, women form the majority of those in the world living in poverty, exposed to violence, forced marriage, and of course, the lack of basic education for girls across the world is still staggeringly low. Gender inequality, according to Oxfam, is the most serious and pervasive form of discrimination, with half of the world's population being women. Only 37% of the GDP is generated. And as many women have talked about this afternoon, seriously held back by structural bias. And I think it was Gillian Martin who talked about the importance and the contribution that women actually make to the economy that's been missed. Findings that show that women value in their employment things like support in line management and support for their return to work, whether it be through illness or maternity leave, are things that women seem to value more than men. And in the STUC report, The Women's Voice and Women's Work, which is an excellent report if you haven't read it, where they talk about positively that there's an unprecedented interest in a collaborative and engaging approach to women in the workplace. Issues such as long-term job security, financial rewards remain problematic. Issues such as the unequal promotion opportunities for women and the lack of research and understanding the barriers to women in employment. And I'm pleased that Jamie Hepburn, the Minister, has acknowledged the work that needs to be done in researching that further, and particularly in relation to older women. I believe, like many other women, that a woman's place is in the union. And I think that perhaps trade unions are an unexplored source for researching barriers for work. And I would like to commend the Minister, if he hasn't already thought about talking to the trade unions, sharing the advisory panel. And as a former full-time trade union official, I can testify to the many women who would face alone employment discrimination if it were not for their unions. Unions themselves remain male-dominated. And in fact, it highlights that organisationally, women are not represented at the top. 55% of men and women are not in trade unions. I think a matter for another day, but it does highlight the issue of women that probably need to be in trade unions. the question of older women in the workplace, I think that there are issues such as the health deficit for, I think, older workers in general, and the demographics show that we do need to address this because that demographic is going to be increasing for the next two decades. Just want to say a word or two on the issue of childcare. And I think we have to ask ourselves the question, what does flexible childcare actually look like? I do think it's one of the policy areas that does require a national all-party focus, and I don't think we've got this quite right up until now. And of course, Scottish Labour supports free childcare. We introduced it when in government, and I support this. But I do think that sometimes it has been at the expense of working out how we could create a more flexible childcare policy and workplace nurseries in particular. Gillian Martin also talked about the importance of childcare and how women could actually work a lot smarter and longer if they were given that flexible aspect of childcare. The causes that many members have talked about of the pay gap, I think we're all agreed. The occupational segregation is one of the main causes, the way that society is structured, and Mark Griffin and others and Monica Lennon just talked about how early that sets in a girl's life if she doesn't have parents who are going to promote that she has an equal opportunity. And the role that women play in caring, of course, is vital to that. In closing, Presiding Officer, I'm glad that the Scottish Government are going to accept Labour's amendment, and I spoke to the fact why we think that's important. And of course, we will not be supporting the Tory amendment tonight. As Ben Johnson and others have said, we support the real living wage and not the one manufactured by John Osborne to undermine working families' tax credits. I'd never met a Tory in my union career who either supported the minimum wage or the living wage. They're very convenient supporting it now. So for those reasons, we cannot support the Tory amendment tonight. I support the main motion tonight, amended by Scottish Labour. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
I call on Liam Kerr. Around 8 minutes, please, Mr Kerr.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. We are grateful to Jamie Hepburn for bringing this debate. As shown by the small amendment, there is much with which we agree. Certainly, Jamie Hepburn is right to say that many stereotypes start early and feed through to adulthood via course choices, and we agree it is essential to challenge such stereotypes. Monica Lennon is right to highlight gendered materials. I'm particularly glad to hear Gillian Martin bringing up flexible working for dads, something I'm particularly passionate about. And above all, we do not argue with Alex Rowley in his call for a joined-up strategy. And we heed his call for action from the Scottish Government, not more debate. But there is much good work being done. Indeed, in my own experience as an employment lawyer, principally advising the oil and gas industry, it is notable that the generalised statistics and blunt conclusions relied on by some mask many subtleties. As Ben McPherson says, 51% of the 11,000 practising solicitors in Scotland are female. 64% of those are under 40. The percentage of female executives at a major oil company that I've dealt with more than doubled between 2000 and 2014. And just on a side note, I can reassure Christine McKelvey that the UK legislation goes well beyond the European de minimis on maternity and pregnancy. This positive change towards more gender-balanced industries is hugely encouraging, although we would accept that it is a long way from generalizable across all sectors. But all of this progress, all of it, has been done without mandatory quotas or top-down diktats. The reason the legal profession is attracting more women is because it realized that a more balanced workforce makes for a better workforce and adapted accordingly. It is also increasingly receptive to flexible working and family commitments. More women have been attracted into the oil and gas industry because universities, technical colleges, schools, and industry have worked together in a joined-up approach to make the industry more attractive. The three largest parties here are currently led by women, not one of whom got to that position because of quotas or positive discrimination. These women, and before them, Annabel Goldie, Wendy Alexander, Joanne Lamont, got there because of ability and on merit. Now, as Annie Wells said at the outset, imposing equal numbers of women onto boards rather than selection on merit leads to deterioration in operating performance, negative attitudes and responses towards the promoted women, the masking of underlying problems with attitudes and infrastructure, and ultimately the devaluing of women in both their own self-esteem and their perception by those they work with. Gender quotas and positive discrimination are not just anti-meritocratic in principle, they are also counterproductive in practice. Yes, of course.
Monica Lennon.
Thank you. I wonder if Liam Kerr would like to explain. We've talked a lot about merit, but we see your benches are full of men. Is there a problem with Conservative women in your party? Were they not good enough to be selected?
Liam Kerr.
On the contrary... We simply need the Scottish electorate to do what it started to do a month ago and start voting for more Scottish Conservatives, and that's the way to increase our benches. The reason there are fewer women on boards is not a function of institutional sexism, although I accept there may be a residual element. There are myriad, as many speakers have said, there are myriad social and economic factors at play, including, as Claire Adamson rightly says, unconscious bias. We should achieve equality by winning the argument, not by bludgeoning businesses into compliance without addressing the fundamentals underpinning the current differences. Now, moving on, I would be surprised if this chamber did not support our amendment in relation to encouraging men into careers that are female-dominated. As Rachel Hamilton says, that cannot be done in the context of cutting 152,000 college places. We need more men in teaching, for example. Far too often, we read reports that young men turn to crime or bad behaviour due to a lack of male role models in the school environment. Only 9% of primary school teachers today are male. 9%. In education overall, the numbers hovers around 23%. Now, I think that's appalling. So I fully support Annie Wells when she says in her amendment that work must be done to support male and female representation across all professions. And Ruth Maguire, I thought, spoke very well on this. I simply cannot imagine that this chamber will refuse to support our amendment on that basis. Now, I cannot conclude this response without briefly turning to the contribution of the Liberal Democrats. Those coming in late or who have popped out during this debate may not be aware that the Liberal Democrats have made no contribution to this debate, mainly because not a single one has attended it this afternoon. Now, perhaps that's only to be expected from a party which has no female MSPs or MPs, has never had a female leader, either here or in Westminster, and this year, in this past election, saw a well-respected, hard-working female MSP toppled from the top of the North East regional list to be replaced by a man. I mean, no offence to the member personally, but it hardly screams equality. I do not want to kick a party that is down much, but on a motion such as this, I find that unacceptable. And I find it unacceptable that on what is a cross-party collaborative approach, they have not shown up at all throughout this debate. We must do more. And we can do more to break down the barriers that still exist in all workplaces and for all genders. Education is key. Fostering an enthusiasm in girls for engineering, science and maths is key. Encouraging the private sector is key. Getting more male teachers to foster and encourage the next generation is key. Making childcare more accessible and affordable is key. Positive discrimination and quotas are not. Nor is a semantic point on the national minimum wage, national living wage, a reason not to support the amendment, as Jamie Hepburn and Alex Rowley suggest. The Scottish Government may not feel it is enough, but I'm sure they do welcome the increase as craved by the motion, particularly as when it was passed by the Chancellor, it was higher than what the SNP were proposing at the time. This chamber calls for collaboration, so let's have a bit more of that and a bit less opportunism. Accordingly, I commend the amendment to this chamber.
I now call Angela Constance to wind up the debate, and can I say there is a little time in hand. So a little bit upwards of 10 minutes, please, Ms Constance.
I regret that, Presiding Officer. thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and thank you to everybody who has contributed to this afternoon's debate. There's been some thoughtful, very worthy contributions, although I am somewhat perplexed that some of our colleagues and members on the Tory benches seem to have never have heard of the glass ceiling. And they fail to recognise that the underrepresentation of women in every aspect of our economy and indeed civic life is oppressive, it's an exclusion, and it's quite simply wrong. And what we in this Parliament have to guard against at all costs. Yes, we've got our first woman First Minister, and I'm absolutely positive that she'll do far more for women than the first woman Prime Minister ever did.
Absolutely.
And yes, three of our party leaders are women. And yes, in Scotland, we've got the first ever 50-50 gender-balanced Scottish Government cabinet. But what we have to guard against is the complacency, because having a few women at the top, particularly in this place, doesn't replace the absent women that are absent from our benches. And I was very proud to be one of the MSPs that signed up to the 50-50 campaign. And as we progress with this Parliament, I look forward to bringing forward the 50-50 legislation for public appointments to public sector boards. And obviously, we will return to this issue. But we really have to guard against, and particularly the women that are here, we have to guard against saying that just because we've managed to get elected or that we've managed to get into positions of powers, that surely other women can manage it too, because there are very visible and invisible barriers that exist for women the length and breadth of this country, and it is beholden on us, more so those of us who have the privilege of elected position and being ministers, to do everything that we can to absolutely kick down that glass ceiling. As I said, Presiding Officer, we have had some thoughtful contributions, and we heard from Gillian Martin and Rachel Hamilton as they both reflected on their quite personal experiences of maternity and pregnancy discrimination. And I certainly recall having to come into this Parliament when my own son was only days old, and that is most certainly not a boast. It was a matter of necessity, but it's also a matter of regret. And this Parliament should always seek to lead and to set an example. And that's why this government, whether it's myself or indeed Mr Hepburn, are absolutely determined to work hand in glove with the European Human Rights Commission based here in Scotland, bearing in mind the plight of 54,000 women in Scotland who, despite living in the 21st century, continue to experience discrimination around being pregnant and giving birth, a time in your life that should be the absolute happiest. There's been a fair reflection of the achievements that we've made as a Parliament and as a country, but there's been a very honest acknowledgement of what remains to be done. Yes, the full-time gender pay gap has decreased, and it's lower in Scotland than it is in the UK, and that's the same for the overall gender pay gap figures. But our comparisons should be further afield than just our nearest friend and neighbours. And of course, the pay gap for the over 50s is particularly stubborn and persistent, and it is perhaps related to that premium on caring that women in particular have. And I think Pauline McNeill was quite right to say that we should be looking at this issue in more depth. And certainly, when I was chairing in a former post the strategic group on women in work, certainly the trade unionists represented in that group were already very engaged in those issues. And we should remember that 40% of families rely on help from grandparents to care for their children. It is, of course, heartening that we have a higher employment rate with lower unemployment and inactivity, that we have the second highest employment rate for women in Europe. But we also have to acknowledge that employment for women over the year has decreased by 35,000 and inactivity, economic inactivity for women has increased by 43,000. So we are certainly, when it comes to the economy, we are not out of the woods yet. And we should always, always scratch beneath those headline statistics, because our research, Scottish Government research, shows that countries which have pioneered the sort of policies that the Scottish Government is pursuing do not necessarily have the lowest pay gaps. So we have to work even harder and ensure that all the arrows are flying in the right direction and that we do indeed have that joined up approach, joined up government and joined up Civic Scotland. It would of course be remiss of me not to reiterate calls on those local authorities who have not settled their equal pay claims. And it would also be remiss of me, particularly in the aftermath of Thursday's referendum result, not to acknowledge the pivotal role that the EU has played in advancing women's equality. Equal pay, maternity leave, shared parental leave, and anti-discrimination laws are just some of the rights and protections that are enshrined within EU law. And whatever happens in the coming months and years, I want people to be assured that this Scottish Government will always seek to uphold these rights and to uphold these protections, which have done so much to progress women's equality. As mentioned already, the Government is accepting the Labour Party amendment. It rightly recognises the negative impact on our economy of occupational segregation and indeed the underrepresentation of women in our economy and in particular in STEM. And as we all know, there are not many guarantees when you try and predict our economic future, but that focus on STEM has to be and is a sure bet. We also know that addressing occupational segregation is a particularly wicked issue. There is no country in the world that has solved occupational segregation. Indeed, there are some countries that do better in particular sectors, and we should seek to cast our eyes far and wide and learn from the best international practice. But perhaps we should all tonight unite and be determined that Scotland perhaps could be the first country to finally crack occupational segregation. And we know that inequality in the workplace, that solving, challenging and tackling inequality in the workplace, that it's not just the right thing to do, it is actually the smart thing to do for the future of our country and indeed the future of our economy. And if I can quote from the Bank of Scotland, who say, being able to attract, develop, fully utilise and retain top female talent is highly important to us, and we recognise that companies with gender diverse senior management teams perform better. So gender diversity is absolutely good for business. It chimes with our agenda on inclusive growth, and inclusive growth is very much at the heart of this government's economic strategy. We want an economy that works for the common good. And we know that promoting economic growth and tackling inequality absolutely have to be two sides of the same coin. So we will continue to support and promote the real living wage, and we won't be supporting the Tory amendment, which in essence is really just a tinkering for some around the national minimum wage. And again, there is very strong evidence that the living wage is good for business. It increases productivity, and most importantly, It makes people feel valued in the workplace. And if I can quote one nursery worker from West Lothian who says that the living wage also makes me feel more confident and valued whilst I'm working, and I recognise that I'm appreciated for doing my job, and that even rubs off on the children I'm looking after. So the real living wage is a societal good that we should all be campaigning, supporting and advancing every opportunity that we have. Presiding Officer, many people have focused on the importance of STEM. I want to briefly highlight that we should recognise that the number of SQA exam passes by girls in STEM subjects has risen between 2007 and 2015, and that 48% of passes in STEM subjects are from young women. But of course, we know there is more to do. We know that young women are well represented in biology, but less so physics. And we do indeed have a startling challenge in and around ICT, for example. And we have to be attracting and encouraging more women and more young people into these productive sectors. They are sectors for the future, and we're really missing a trick, and our economy will miss a trick if we can't get more women into a sector that is crying out for them. As I said earlier, Presiding Officer, we really have to ensure that all the arrows are flying in the right direction. We need a comprehensive response. And in essence, that's my job, to join up the strategy, join up the dots between the early years, the developing Scotland's young workforce, ensuring that those gendered action plans that the Funding Council, Skills Development Scotland are pursuing are actually having an impact on the ground. We, of course, are advancing early years and free childcare, the biggest infrastructure project undertaken by this government. Flexible working, as many members has mentioned, is absolutely crucial, as is the reporting of the pay gap and occupational segregation. And I just want to end, Presiding Officer, by briefly touching upon the new powers that will come to this Parliament. And it is important that we don't confuse social security powers in relation to disability and carers, benefits that are there to assist people with the additional cost of living with a disability, that we should not confuse those with the employment programmes, the limited employment programmes that are being devolved to this Parliament. But nonetheless, with the devolution of the Work Choice programme and the Work programme, we will make different choices. And there are indeed opportunities that Andy Whiteman spoke of having more gender-sensitive employability programmes. And I'm very proud of the fact that this government has funded Scottish Women's Aid, who work in partnership with various local services, with an employment programme that supports women, women who have been financially dependent on an abusive partner, who have additional barriers into the workplace. So there are already examples of employability programmes targeted at the specific needs of women. But this is an area that we will have to pursue further, and I know that Mr Hepburn will relish that task as he takes it forward. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. That concludes our debate on gender in the workplace. The next item of business is consideration of business motion 629 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau, setting out a business programme. I would ask any member who wishes to speak against this motion to press the request to speak button now. And I call on Mr Fitzpatrick to move motion 629.
Formally moved.
Thank you. And no member has asked to speak against the motion. I'll put the question to the Chamber. Are we agreed with motion number 629? We are agreed. The motion is agreed to. The next item of business is consideration of three Parliamentary Bureau motions. I ask Joe Fitzpatrick to move motion 630 on variation of standing orders, motion number 631 on substitution on committees, and motion number 633 on memberships of committees on block.
Moved on block.
The question on these motions will come at decision time, to which we now come. And there are four questions at decision time today. The first question is that Amendment 607.1 in the name of Annie Wells, which seeks to amend Motion 607 in the name of Jamie Hepburn on gender in the workplace, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We're not agreed. We'll move to a vote, and members may cast their votes now. The result of the vote on Amendment 607.1 in the name of Annie Wells is as follows. Yes, 30. No, 93. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed. The next question is that Amendment 607.2 in the name of Alec Rowley be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. The next question is that Motion 607 in the name of Jamie Hepburn as amended be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. I propose to put a single question on Parliamentary Bureau Motions 630, 631 and 633. If any member objects, please say so now. No one does. I therefore ask the Chamber that Motion 630, 631 and 633 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick be agreed. Are we agreed?
Yes.
And we are agreed. That concludes decision time. We'll now move to members' business. I would ask members to move quietly, and I'll take a few moments to allow members to change places.